Thank you, everybody. Vanakkam, I am Ashwanth. I am from India. And 14 years ago, I was in the UK to do my MBA. And post that, I had got an internship with Procter & Gamble at Surrey. I took that internship. I had the opportunity to pursue the job here. I didn't do it. I went back home to join the Indian bureaucratic services, civil services. And I wrote the exam. It's one of the toughest competitive exams in the country. That's what I thought. So I gave my first attempt. I failed miserably. I was pursuing my second attempt, so way back in 2005, when I just heard through a common friend about this young girl trying to do something in the villages. So I will go to that. But before that, I just thought I'll give a quick background of what I want to say here. And before that, I want to know if any of you have heard about the term outsourcing before. Outsourcing, have any of you heard about the term outsourcing? That's good. BPO, business process outsourcing. Social enterprise. Okay, great. So now that many of you know it, I can say whatever I want. Thank you. Okay, great. So I was told to give a brief about myself. I asked Richie if I could say a few things about myself. I don't get the chance many a time. The reason I wanted to put all these pictures about myself is just to give you a context of what can be done, you know. So I am a right-handed middle-order batsman. That's what I like to call myself. I'm a triathlete. I'm an Olympic triathlete. I've completed about 6 triathlons so far. I'm a half marathoner. I take part in theater. I'm a couch surfer. I love to write. My book is still work in progress for the last 13 years, but I will eventually publish someday. And I believe that cricket is a religion, and Sachin is God. So all the things that I've listed here does not pay me anything. I just do this because I like to do all of these things, all of these activities. Now in between, I have a full-time job that pays for all the things that I want to pursue. And now, it's about that particular role and about the company is what I wanted to share with you. And more than outsourcing or the industry of BPO, I thought it'd be great if we can just share our stories of how we went about setting this whole venture up, what are the challenges that we faced, what we are still facing, and how we are kind of enduring it. So it's really awesome that somebody actually calls us to share our stories, because generally I don't talk a lot, but the problem is when I start talking, I don't stop. So I'm giving you the full license to punctuate me whenever appropriate. Just raise your hand, throw something at me if you want to stop. Yeah. So I'll start from there. Yes, so DesiCrew Solutions is a rural BPO company. It's an impact sourcing company. We set up outsourcing centers in rural areas, in villages of India. The idea to set up these was because we thought by creating jobs in rural areas, we can create wealth in the local community. Educated youngsters don't have to move from villages to cities in search of jobs. So I'll talk a little bit more about how we started. Currently, we are a 10-year-old company. We offer back office support to customers from across the globe. Google Maps, must you use Google Maps? Yes. You don't use Google Maps? Oh, you do, right. So the data that you see on Google Maps, the roads, the points of interest. So our team, we have worked with Google to plot the data on maps. So we worked with Google for about 4 years to plot data on maps. So we work with companies like Procter & Gamble to do their back-end work. So outsourcing, as you would know, the only difference is that the work goes all the way down to villages. So that's what we do. We are a 600 people organization as of now, quite small for our for the 10 years that we've been in. But we've had some interesting customers and we've had some very interesting episodes in our journey. So India, how many of you are from South Asia? South Asia, anybody from here? Okay, great. So these are some of the visuals that are, that kind of come to one's mind, you know, agriculture, farming, bullock carts on the road, when you say villages back in India. Even now, around 68% of our population, of the Indian population, are still living in villages. And nearly 50% of our earnings are coming from agriculture. India as a country, we are extremely proud of the fact that we have the the youngest demographic in the world at this point of time. The largest population of people in the age bracket of 18 to 35 are in India, so which means we have a very employable workforce. But unfortunately, most of these youngsters or these age group of people are in villages. And now, not many of them want to turn to agriculture. So what do? They end up coming to cities. There's urban migration. Are they able to take up jobs as per their qualifications? Are they able to build a career? How much of their wealth is actually being created in the cities? How much of it goes back to the villages? So all of these were questions that were there. These are just some of the questions. So this lady is Saloni Malhotra. She is the founder of DesiCrew. So 2003, she was about 22, 23 at that time. She was working in a media agency. In Delhi. Delhi is the capital of the country. And she heard the lecture of a professor from an institute on rural telecommunication and business models. So she was somebody who was interested to do something in rural areas, but did not know what. So it was an accidental lecture that she heard. She just wrote to him randomly. And she just quit her job, landed at the IIT that is in the south of the country. For a girl who does not know the local language, it was a huge step. She's never been to that part of the country. She just landed at the IIT. She took up the role of a project associate. She was earning about $30 a month. So that's what a project associate would get. So she left her well-paying job at Delhi, a good career that was there in front of her. She just landed at the IIT, hoping to build something. But she had no idea what she was going to do. She wanted to do something in the villages. She wanted to do a for-profit entity, a business model. She did not want to do an NGO, or she did not want to pursue the charity route. So the three dots, as we call it at our story, create a business model, use technology, and have social impact. So these three dots. So we tried to connect these three, and that was the time, way back in 2004-05, was when outsourcing was creating a lot of jobs in India. So you had call centers, you had back office work, you had accounting work, all of that coming all the way from LA, from the Bay Area to Delhi and Hyderabad and Bangalore. So if jobs can go from one continent to another, why can't it go from the metro city to the village? If you can set the infrastructure right, and if you can train the resources, the jobs can actually travel rather than people having to travel to jobs. So this was a kind of, what I'm saying is just the result of almost a year of research that she had done. She had visited a lot of villages, she met a lot of youngsters, she found that even though they had completed their undergraduate degrees, the government provides a lot of subsidies for youngsters to complete their high school and college graduation. But after graduation, they did not want to enter agriculture. Now, coming from villages, they were not able to live or adapt themselves strongly to the metro or a tier one city kind of lifestyle. So a lot of these youngsters, despite having good quality graduation, were not able to get a job. The fate of the girls were even worse. Girls were not allowed to travel to cities. So what eventually happened was, you had youngsters, women, young girls who had completed their graduation, would not go to job, just wait till they get married at 21, 22. So this was a kind of a project that Saloni did by physically visiting all these villages. We visited almost about 45 to 48 villages, and we had the data compiled. And we also followed up with the fate of students who traveled to cities. So we found that even though there were a lot of young boys who went to cities in search of jobs, not all of them were qualitatively engaged. Their soft skills were poor, their English skills were poor. In spite of having a college degree, they were not able to, you know, go up the corporate ladder. A lot of them returned back home. So the idea was that if we can set up the infrastructure right in these villages, and if we can train the youngsters, we were kind of sure that we could replicate the outsourcing model. You know, when jobs come from LA to Delhi, why can't it go from Delhi to Sitapur? So that was the idea with which, in 2007, we registered this company called DesiCrew Solutions Private Limited. Now, I had met Saloni through a common friend, and we kind of got along well from day one. And she said that she still could not speak the local language, and I could speak the local language. So we agreed that I will handle the back end of DesiCrew, that is the people, training, and HR, while she'll handle the front end of customers, customer acquisition, and investment and finance. It worked well for me because I wanted to do the civil services and I failed. I was preparing for my second attempt, but then I thought this was giving me a hands-on experience of working in rural areas. So it is one thing to study and go through the system to work in rural areas, but it's another to actually have a hands-on experience of directly starting a business venture in villages. So we kind of got along well. We started off from there. Now, Saloni's background is that her parents were doctors, and she did not come from any business background. And I was about 22 at that time. I didn't have much of a work experience at that time. So the two of us were just like people who passed out of college with not much of business experience, but we strongly believed that if we can make this work, we're going to have a significant impact in the areas that we work. So with that as a starting point, we registered the company as a for-profit entity, and we received an initial seed funding. So it wasn't a huge capital that we got. So we just had an initial seed funding from the IIT. IIT is the Indian Institute of Technology. It's one of the premier engineering and research institutes in the country. So we were one of the first companies to be incubated out of the IIT campus. So, by the way, this whole presentation, I'm just going to have a lot of pictures and just probably refer to them. And there might be an odd video in between. Yeah. So the first picture was taken way back in 2007 when we had received our registration certificate. So that was at the IIT campus. And for us, we strongly believe that the people in the villages are capable of delivering good quality work. But the challenge was, who was going to give us work? And we thought that if we train the people adequately, we'll have a strong story. We thought the CSR would be a good, corporate social responsibility would be a good reason for people to work with us. In the early days, a lot of people said, yes, the concept is nice. We like what you do. We like the whole idea of giving work to rural people, but I can't give my work to you. You know, what about the infrastructure? What about the people skill set? What about seamless internet? So with all these as a challenge, it was important that the early team, the foundation team that we had, were a bunch of people who were talented and skilled in the work that we did, but more importantly, we were passionate about the whole model. To begin with, while we had a seed funding, we never got a revenue, so which means we didn't have salaries for ourselves. So there were a series of few months in the initial stage where whatever revenue we could generate, we would eventually pass on to our employees at the villages, which would mean there would be no money for us. So, but we thought that, you know, winter will be over. There'll be some day where work will come and we can take our due. But eventually things did turn. It turned for the better. But what is important here was that there was a bunch of young people at that time who were willing to forego well-paying jobs to be with us, who believed in this model. And full credit to Saloni to kind of keep this kind of a team together. So all the time, so in the initial stages, we thought that when you do work in villages, people in rural areas can do only entry level work. You know, they can't be given very complicated, highly technical work. So we thought they can do simple work like data entry. You give them a form, they'll type it and we can send it back. So that was the kind of work that we thought we could do. But over a period of time, because of the opportunities that we got, we were able to kind of do slightly knowledge-based work, the Google Maps that I told you. Now, my employees are people who have not gone outside the state of Tamil Nadu, but they have plotted data on almost the 75 countries. They can talk to you in the language of latitude and longitude coordinates. They can talk to you about the Iceland airport. They can tell you how many dharmashalas are there in Bhutan. So we were kind of surprised when people responded to us positively, when we gave them a pilot. So from the time we started and to the time that we work now and the days ahead, we've always kept the interest of the customers in our mind. So as a managerial student, we never go and tell our customer that I can do data entry work for you. We try to ask them, is there a pain point in your operations? Is there something that you're looking at improving in efficiency? And then we try to reply to them saying that we can do that for you. So the interest of the customer has always been a primal focus of conversation. So right from Google to AOL to Walmart Technologies to Procter & Gamble, Twitter, all of these companies, we've done an array of work, but none of it is because we had the skill sets at our team. We never, for Twitter, we kind of tested their social media tool that they were developing. It's not that we had programmers at the back end. It's because Twitter said they had a problem and we created a team at the back end. And we were eventually able to work with them. So keeping the customer interest has always been a fundamental part of our DNA, whoever the customer is. Now, as I mentioned earlier, Saloni and myself were never from the business background. Even till date, our investors say that we're not a bunch of people who can make money. We can never make money in life. Because those were days when we would say yes to any project. There would be somebody who calls up and says, hey, I have a thesis that needs to be digitized. The entire value of that activity is about $10. You know, it's a 500-page thesis, I have to type it for them, and they'll pay me $10 at the end. But we would spend nearly $22 in trying to go to the client, collect the thesis, courier it to our center, finish the work, courier it back, and return it. So eventually, we would be a net negative company for all the little things that we did. Our negotiation skills were extremely poor. A lot of times when we signed in contracts and then we spoke to some of our peers or our mentors, they would be wondering as to why we even agreed to do it at this rate. I mean, this was much below the market rates. So we learned all these things the hard way. But for us, it was at the end that the customer agreed. So there were times when we felt that we've been exploited. But at the end of it, we felt that if the customer is happy, all's well. But I do not know how much of it would make business sense. But as a company, that's how we kind of started. And that helped us to survive. And it kind of gave the perception to the customers that we are an honest bunch of people, which we were. And we never let money come between us and a good idea. So there would be times when we would have to travel to the villages and we would not have money for the tickets. So we would have to travel on the third class. We wouldn't have money for the local cabs when we go to the villages. We would hire cycles. For food, there wouldn't be much of food, so we would just live on bananas and apples. But in spite of that, we would sit and talk about, so what will we do if DesiCrew goes for an IPO? You know, how do we create ESOPs for our employees? And so Saloni would be like, okay, we can talk about that later. First pay 10 rupees to the bus ticket. So even in spite of living in absolute misery with no money, we never let our dreams go down. We would talk about how Google is coming out with this exciting thing called driverless cars. Can we do something for them? And Saloni would not have money to pay her rent. So that's the kind of an initial start that we did. But at any point of time, we would always be talking big, we would always be dreaming big, we would always be talking about how we can improve the efficiencies, but we never would worry about, or we would never talk about our misery of finances. So that kind of helped us to keep the positivity around when we were in the office. We were a bunch of crazy people and we did really crazy jobs. Sorry?
So how did you do?
How did you?
How did you do with no money?
Yeah, parents. Saloni's father was, Saloni's father was in Delhi, and when he found that his daughter was traveling in the buses in the villages and she was taking the local buses, he was upset and he put a loan and he got a car delivered to her. So we all were happy that Saloni got the car now that we could move about. Problem was, who was going to pay for the fuel? So the car was lying unattended most of the time, but when we had a client visit, we would borrow money, load it with fuel, take them around to our center and come back. In fact, that incidentally, that really helped. The head of Google India was visiting the IIT campus. And on a Sunday, he was walking with a professor. IIT is a huge 650-acre campus. So on a Sunday, when he was just walking, he saw the lights at one of the halls. So we were given a space in a computer lab. So when he walked to the professor, he saw Saloni sitting and working on a Sunday. He was very impressed that a young girl is working on Sunday. So he asked what she was doing, and this was in 2007, and this was the head of Google India called Prasad Ram. So he was really impressed, and he kind of gave time to Saloni. He said, okay, let's go visit your center. So this girl, in her broken down hatchback, drove the head of Google India for about 5 hours on the road to our center to see three people working on broken down computers. So to us, so we were never embarrassed at that point of time. We were happy to have somebody visit our center. And it so happened that he was kind of impressed with what he saw, and he said, you know, at Google we are developing something known as Maps, and we're having a challenge. This was in 2007. So they were hiring engineers, GIS engineers, in Hyderabad and Bangalore, and paying them good salaries, and giving them 4-day working, 4 days a work week, with only 6 hours of work, unlimited food, pick up and drop, anytime in the 24 hours of work slot. But they were having attrition of over 50%. The reason? Engineers were asked to draw lines on maps. What you see as roads and points of interest were initially being made to do with engineers. And obviously, engineers didn't like to sit and draw lines on maps. So they were quitting the job in spite of the high salary. So he said, can you do something? So they said they needed people with geography degree. We said, we don't have geography degree in Tamil Nadu. So we took the project. We asked them a month's time. We trained up people in geography, latitude, longitude, and basic map skills. Fortunately for us, our people qualified. They were certified. And then we found that our productivity was almost double. You know, Google wanted us to do about 450 kilometers of drawing every day. Our people would do about 700 to 750, and they wouldn't want to go home. The simple reason is these people had never seen satellite images before. So for them to see something as exciting as a live satellite image and to draw lines was pretty exciting. So it worked in our favor. The numbers went up. And it all started because Saloni offered to take him on a drive on that car. So we in 2008-09 itself, we kind of wrote to a London hospital. There was a project that came from London. It still is going around. The project is that you had to digitize birth records of London hospitals of 18th century. So you had over 2 million documents, all of them dating back from 1735 to 1760, handwritten documents, birth records of London citizens at that point of time. So these are age-old, these almost were 300-year-old documents. And when, at that time, the handwriting was more like calligraphy. It was more like a painting. So the scanned images were sent to us. We had to see the content and type it. So we thought it was an easy task. We just picked it up. So every child born had the church name, a parish name, address, father's name, mother's name, and a few other details. We could not go beyond the name of the child because the handwritings were like, were in a completely different art form altogether. So we try to take up everything that comes our way. We would burn our fingers miserably a lot of time. We wrote to the Carnegie Mellon University saying that we will digitize their lectures. Give us your video lectures. We will type it so that you can create subtitles. So we wrote to the Carnegie Mellon Library. We could not do more than even 2 minutes of their content. They gave us about 5 hours of video. We couldn't do more than 2 minutes. We realized that our English skills were very poor. But still, we would continue doing or whatever came along our way, we would continue taking whatever came along our way. And Saloni has been very insistent on using technology to solve some of our problems. I don't know if you heard about the issue of power cut. Have you all, in the regions where you come, have you suffered a power cut? So,
yes, morning.
Oh, okay, wow. How long, 30 seconds?
I couldn't buy my train tickets.
So those are some of the centers. I will show some of our centers as to how they work. So we basically operate out of villages, where the population the population is less than about 20,000 people, where there are no other non-agricultural job opportunities, so which makes it viable for people to come and work for us. So we have our centers that are like a no-frills functional center. We don't have air conditioning. We don't have fancy pantries. But it's a functional data secure center, which our customers would want as a minimum. So the first building is a 150-year-old post office, which was then a soda factory, which is then converted into a secure delivery center, where we do work for the likes of, I don't know if you heard about Zomato, Deliveroo, Procter & Gamble, Infosys. And our training setup, so we don't have the facility, or we don't look for a facility to have a proper training setup. So we set up our training setups in the field itself. Just outside our center would be the open field. So we kind of made use of whatever resources were available with us, but at the same time, it was functional. So when I work with my customer, they do an IT audit. There is always a data security check. So while I meet all of that, we had to ensure that our rural centers were functional. So yeah, that's where we are. We started off in 2007. We were one of the first companies in India to set up outsourcing centers in villages. Currently, we have over 50 customers. We have 500 plus. Last month, we touched 600. That's our biggest number so far. We've won over 15 awards, both at the national and at the international forum. So our customers are from different sectors, likes of Google, AOL come under the new media section. We work with insurance companies that are based in India. A lot of exciting things are happening at the social media sector. There's content moderation. We help in e-learning content. But what's happening is that 10 years ago, the skills that I had, that I wanted my people to have, are becoming redundant right now. So with the automation, with RPA, with artificial intelligence, with machine learning, our skills, the need for people, are becoming redundant. So that's one of the challenges that we are facing. I will talk about that as we move. So in 2007, we were 30 people. We initially thought people could do simple data entry work. You give them an application form, you send it over the internet, they will type it and they'll send it back. 2008, we started off with GIS plotting. We did localization of content. We started doing secondary research for companies like Reuters, which help, I mean, the data points that help them to prepare their content. And then as time moved on, as different sectors started coming up, e-commerce company, QA support, so we started adding different sectors. Now, if you know the outsourcing industry, you don't have a company that does all these crazy things. An outsourcing company is good at F&A, that's finance and accounting. They focus a lot on F&A. An outsourcing company is good at HRO, they focus on HRO. But we are the kind of people who kind of have a surface knowledge on a lot of things, and we end up putting our fingers in all the things that come across. So now, we've realized that it's one thing to set up brick and mortar centers, but it's also another thing to have a platform where customers can come and dump their work, and we can have resources sitting at villages connected via secure mode who can do the work. So that's QA on cloud. That's one of the things that we're still working on. These are the services. I just prepared this for my customers. Honestly, I have no idea what most of them would mean. It's just that customers like to see the services that we talk about. So I just put them from different sources. So essentially, if a customer wants me to do something, they would consider me as a remote arm of their office that sits outside some 5,000 miles away, secure, having a team that does the work. So how, you must have visited AOL, AOL.com. AOL, the site is still existing here, is it? Right. So our job with AOL, we work with the American team, is to ensure that the portals are all working fine. Our job is just to go to AOL.com, click, see if it's loading, check if all the links are loading, the time it takes to load. See if the ads are working. And they call it cross-browser testing. One of the most boring jobs, but our people love doing it. So we raise tickets as and when the sites are not working. So like that, and this is not an outsourced job per se. What AOL does is not like a regular outsourced job. They just thought that it'll be good to have a team, and because we were able to get certified and we were able to do the work, we kind of took it from them and we're still working with them. The one on the top is the dude won the Nobel Prize, Mohammed Yunus. So he visited our center. He liked the model. So we had some celebrities visiting us. The ones on the right are the founders of Infosys. Infosys is one of the leading IT companies in India. He inaugurated our center at Karnataka. That was the inauguration ceremony. Down right is Masayoshi Tamura. He is the Hitachi head of India. And that is the IT minister. And that's the professor who's in the center, whose speech inspired Saloni to quit her job. And the person next to Saloni is Mr. Mani. He is my current CEO. So what are the challenges that we faced in the early days? So what the market said. So obviously for us, we had to go and talk to customers. Customers would have to give us work. So customers would always say, we love the idea. I mean, it's nice that you guys are doing work in villages. You know, you're going to improve the villages. You're going to empower the villages. We really wish you success, but I can't give you my work. Why? He says, I am from that village. I am from that district. You know, I know that you have over 8 to 10 hours of power cut out there. And internet is unheard of in that region. How can I give you my work when I'm supposed to have seamless power and seamless internet? That is just the infrastructure. Can these people speak English? Will they understand instructions? Will they be able to understand the changes that I'm talking to them? Will they even have telephone connectivity for me to talk to them? So these were some of the issues that people mentioned. To be honest, all of them are true at that point of time. In fact, at one of the locations that we worked, we were the first people to bring in broadband connection. And if you know broadband connection, this generation doesn't even know about the broadband connection. So we actually dug up, we actually wrote to the government and dug up the area for the optic fiber to be laid to bring internet to that village. So we can be credited with the fact that we got internet to some of the villages that we work in. Because we got in the internet for commercial purpose, there were a lot of others who were able to subscribe and take it off from them. This was way back in 2007-8. The issue of power. All the centers at that point of time were suffering from scheduled and unscheduled power cuts. And when I say power cuts, you're talking about 3-4 hours of no power. So no work would happen. But then we didn't have the money to power diesel gensets. We never had the funding to invest in UPS batteries. So that's where our craziness would set in. So we thought PCs need power. Why don't we use laptops? So we invested in laptops and we got spare batteries. So a laptop without power can work for about 3 hours and the spare battery can function for another 3 hours. So we did the crazy thing and we got laptops for our people to work with. It suited the power situation well because in power cuts people were able to work. What we didn't account for was when you're doing a BPO job, you got to type a lot. And within 1 month, the keys started breaking up. That's inexperience for us. So then we thought we'll have a laptop and a mechanical keyboard. So a lot of these things that we did, and the people on the floor had supported us. So they would say that instead of the regular shift, they'll come and work when the electricity is there. So you know, we would kind of do all these weird things. So the customers would be from anywhere. They could be from Bangalore, they could be in the US, they could be anywhere. But they would be like, how do I monitor your work? How do I even know you guys are working? You know, I can't even get through on a direct call with you guys. How do I monitor your work? I need real-time work. So all of these were some of the challenges that we faced at that point of time. So we thought it was only the customers who were a challenge. What we didn't account for were the challenges in the villages itself. We thought by creating jobs in villages, people are going to love us. No, they didn't. My first experience of conducting an interview. So I have this room, I have the interview, we advertised on TV and paper, we have people lined up, and one of the ladies come in, a young girl, she comes with her father. So the father comes along with a girl for the interview. So the father is interviewing me now. He's like, who are you? How come you're coming to this village? Why this village? So what happens to my girl when she comes here? So I was like, I'm supposed to be asking those questions. And the fact that there are two people here is not acceptable. I have to interview the girl who's come for the job and not her father. So it started off like that. A lot of our, like I mentioned, about 70-75% of our staff are women. There are a lot of positives for that, but in the initial stages, we had a lot of challenges because of that. So we've had cases where, like the first phrase, ever since she started earning, my wife has become arrogant. So I got a call from one of the husbands who said that, you got to terminate my wife from services. Why? Because she's earning, she's not listening to me, she's not taking care of the kids, she's not taking care of my parents. We're like, okay, that's not something that we can address on. And there was another case where one of the girl's father called up and said that this job is actually spoiling our family. Why? Because the girl is not agreeing to get married. So those are some of the challenges which we were not prepared for. So we thought it's the customer, it's the business, it's power, it's how do you get the internet? We never thought something as simple as working after 6 o'clock would be a disaster. Now, any outsourcing company would do 24/7 operations. So we've got to run 24/7. Three shifts, multiple shifts have to be working. Now, we've had complaints from parents when they said that they cannot allow their daughters to work after 6. And now this girl was the team leader, and the team cannot function without her. So at one fine day, the parents called up and said that yesterday she came at 7, and that's it, she's not going to come to job anymore. So we had to go talk to them, explain to the family. So that's when we realized a lot of local community engagement has to happen for this model to work. We had cases where people would not come to job because their cow have given delivery to a calf. They would want the daughter to take care of it. We've had cases where women would not come because they had guests coming home. They would say, my children are having school, can I come after school? The concept of working from 9 to 5, the concept of a SLA, a service level agreement, was very difficult for people because they've not worked. Most of them are first generation knowledge workers. Local festivals, now, harvest festival, I mean, my customers don't have harvest festival, I mean, we can give them a 1 day leave, but people would not turn up for 5 days at a stretch. You give them bonus, you threaten them, there's nothing that we could do in the early stage. 5 days, they just would not come. And I can't explain to my customer that we're having the local harvest festival. There were times when our employees had to travel to cities, they had to travel to Pune, to Delhi for training. Now that would be a huge turmoil for us because the parents would not allow the girl to travel. And this girl has to travel. And she can't travel alone. So she has to travel accompanied by another girl. So a lot of complexities which we kind of didn't anticipate, we came our way, we kind of faced them a lot of, I mean, it meant talking and fighting and continuously, you know, engaging the local community in different ways. But HR complications, that's something that we never thought we were prepared for. I thought at least I had that covered. Because you go to a village and you tell people I'm giving you a job, I thought they would be happy. No, they were not. There were a whole bunch of our assumptions that were broken down. And we had to adapt to their requirements. As much as they had to change, we also had to change in the way we could kind of engage with them. This is the boring part of our board of directors and my management. Saurav is an Oxford scholar. He's the one who's building the QA on cloud platform, basically trying to create over 10,000 jobs on the cloud platform. People don't have to come to centers, people don't have to come out of their house. We just create a robust platform in which people can connect from their rural setup, from their homes itself, and work from there. So that's in a beta version already, and that's like DesiCrew's next version. So that's what he's working on. This lady at the bottom, Veena Shetty, she's a classic example of how somebody who is working in a metro, she's worked in Oracle, she had worked in Cisco, got married, then went back to a village. Obviously, she cannot work from Cisco or Oracle from the village. She was sitting at home. When DesiCrew happened, she just joined us, and now she's the head of HR at DesiCrew. So this is what we tell our customers. You know? So whatever I may tell about the impact and creating jobs, it's to the customers, I tell them that they get flexible workforce. I tell them that I can train the people. Don't worry about training them. We have our own training module. I'll prepare them the way you want. I'll certify them before they go on live. Obviously, data security, we talk about low costs. So when you're talking about low cost, we realize that that's the primary reason why customers work with us. I mean, jobs that are done in the US for $15 an hour, $20 an hour, if we are able to do it at 1/3 of the cost and offer the same level of output, they're more than happy. Everything else ceases to exist. It's only the cost arbitrage that most of my customers are looking for, which we give them. And of course, now we have 100% uptime at our centers. All our centers have two levels of power backup, internet backup. In fact, our employees come to work because there is power and fan at the center, whereas they don't have electricity at home. So they're willing to do overtime at the center where there is electricity. So this is something that caught our attention 2 years ago. How many of you are aware of the Sustainable Development Goals? That's one. Anybody else? UN? How many of you are aware of the United Nations?
Yeah.
Oh. You speak for everybody.
Sorry?
Oh, no, I just want a quick check of if everybody's awake. How many of you are aware of the UN? Just put your hands up, or else I have to start talking about the UN right now. Good, all of you are aware. Okay, great. United Nations, yes. So the Sustainable Development Goals were declared in September 2015, and we found that DesiCrew's work, or DesiCrew's mission, is kind of directly aligned to two, three of their goals. Goal number 8, which talks about decent work and economic growth, is exactly what we do. And we thought that was tailor-made for us. And then we realized things like gender equality, quality education. So at DesiCrew, we are an equal opportunity provider. There is there's absolute parity on wages. In fact, there is no consideration. There's nothing to be considered on gender for wages at all. So that's something that we are totally excited about. We've written to the UN. We are working closely with the UN to see how we can kind of, take this model to a larger group of customers. That's one of our centers. And so the impact. So this is Thomas Friedman in his book, Hot, Flat, and Crowded. He actually has mentioned the economic impact of a rural BPO. And he says a rural BPO with about 100 people jobs can actually generate income equivalent to 400 acres of farmland. Now that's a significant amount of economic influx into a village. So that's one of our centers at a place called Tienpalayam, south of India. We find it really difficult to bring everybody into the picture, so a lot of people are actually missed out. And that's some of the numbers that we have. So out of the 600 people we are, 95% of our employees are graduates. We have our cutoff as only high school. Anybody with a high school pass certificate can apply for a job, but invariably 95% of our staff are graduates. The remaining 5 are diploma holders, and we encourage them to complete their degree. 72% of our staff are women. Now, that's a fantastic reason why customers want to work with us, because attrition is a huge problem in metros. I mean, I don't know if you know about it, but in urban areas, BPOs, the attrition is close to about 50%. So imagine the number, the employees that are, who are there in this month are not going to be there the next month. Now, as a HR of the company, it's a nightmare for you. You've got to replace the resources, you've got to train them, and new resources, by the time they come to the optimum level of output, they're out. So it's like a revolving door. You can never get a stable set of resources to work for you. For us, it's at 6%. Now, to me, when I talk to my customers, that's a number that they love, the 6%. The reason for the 6% is because, like I told you, a significant part of our staff are women, and when they get married, they quit the jobs. So we're trying to alter that, but that's something that's work in progress. 100% of our staff are cricket supporters. I mean, I kind of check in the names before they get signed in. Unless or until they answer a couple of queries on Cricket World Cup, they're not in. So all of them support cricket. So, and the 99% quality scores is something that really important to customers. Now all my customers, just because I work out of a village, are not going to lower the standards of work for me. They hold me at the same level of accountability as they hold their other urban vendors. Now AOL has over 100 vendors. The quality scores, the Six Sigma standards that they set for me is the same as they have with the other vendors. No leeway, nothing can be given just because you're a rural setup or an impact sourcing company. So that way the customers treat us on par with the other vendors, and it's also cool because our people also are kind of prepared at the highest standards. So what is the impact that I'm talking about? When I say it's impact sourcing, when I say there's social impact, we didn't realize what a job could do for people. So we conducted a social audit, an independent social audit by a company from Glasgow called Social Audit Network. So it was an independent team of about 6 people. They visited our centers. They spoke to our employees. They spoke to our ex-employees. They spoke to the families. They spoke to the local police station, the bus stop, the petty shop owners, the local banks. So they kind of assessed, and they did. It was a 3-month project that they did. And the report that they gave us kind of reaffirmed the faith that if we can create jobs, if we can create qualitative engagement, economic engagement, social impact will happen on its own. Consider this. The report indicated that nearly 90% of our staff never had a bank account. Their families don't have a bank account at all. So these are the first generation of people who have a bank account. Now for us, that was nothing. I mean, any employee of DesiCrew would get a bank account for their salary to be credited. But we didn't realize that by opening a bank account for them, we're bringing them into the mainstream economy. We're talking about financial inclusion there. Now, something as simple as an employee who earns about, say, 10,000 rupees. Now, if he were to earn 10,000 rupees from a city, he would spend about 50% of that amount living for his living expenses in the city. Now, if he were to be earning the same 10,000 rupees earning in the village, living in the village, the entire 10,000 goes for his living expenses into the village. You're talking about the crazy things that these youngsters do in terms of buying expensive mobile phone, topping it up, buying 2-wheelers on EMI. The girls are extremely smart. They don't spend their money at all. They just save it. They save it for the wedding. So this was something that came out of the social audit report. So we found that the girls don't even withdraw the money. It's just there. And one interesting episode happened. There was a girl who worked with us for 3 years. She quit her job because she was getting married. So as a part of a full and final settlement, there was something known as the Provident Fund, the retirement fund that the government would provide. She didn't even know that that amount was there for her. Her wedding expenses were about 75,000 rupees. This provident fund settlement was about 28,000 rupees. So that was a windfall for her, her parents. Nobody even knew that amount existed. So she was so excited that this became a huge riot after that. So all the employees suddenly wanted to know what are their savings, what are they eligible for. So we are talking about the benefits of compliance and the benefits of financial inclusion. Now these all came out because of the social audit that we did. Like I told you, there have been many cases where parents call and tell us that the girls are not wanting to get married. I mean, arranged marriages are the norm in India. So the girls would be married off at the age of 18, 19, when the parents decide and who their parents decide they want to get married to. So the social audit report showed that the marriage age, average marriage age of the girls have moved from 19 to 24 because the girls are earning money and they're earning more money than their parents. The parents are farmers, parents are depend on government funding. Now these girls are earning a stable income that kind of supports the family. So the parents don't want to lose the earning hands. So we also saw what economic independence can do in terms of a social esteem in the community. So coming back to the specific slide, so this is what we offer to our employees when they join us. So we provide them with certified skill development in terms of Six Sigma training or spoken English or project management courses. We help them in pursuing their masters, we help them in completing their degrees, we reimburse their fees, we kind of, depending on the scores that they obtain, it could be even a full reimbursement of the expenses. So for people who are keen on pursuing a professional course, we give them flexible work hours, we provide them with part-time opportunities. Now all of this, from a local perspective, there are no other companies that would offer to them in their village. They don't have too many job opportunities in their villages at all. So we have our own training program. We call it Deep Touch. So this is a 3-month training program that we provide free of cost to all our new employees. So for you, something as simple, I mean, these might look absolutely fundamental, right? But for the team and for the people, for them to go through this for 3 months and to get certified itself is a huge achievement. And only when those who clear this kind of get into a full-time role with DesiCrew. And all of this was done by us. We didn't have the money to engage with training content providers or online course providers. So whatever we thought was essential, whatever we heard from our customers as important, we kind of put into this module and kind of package it out as a training program. So 10 years ago, data entry was a very important skill. You know, employees had to type very fast. You know, how many of you know your typing speed here? Typing speed? Yes. How many words a minute?
60.
Sorry?
60.
60. That's high. So we've had the fastest that DesiCrew can do at about 85 words a minute. I am stuck at 40, so they would not give me the job. But typing is one of the key skills that we impart to our people. But what we realize is, no longer customers need typing. 10 years ago, I had banks and telecom companies that give me thousands of application forms a day, handwritten forms, and ask me to type it out. You know, they would scan it and send it, and we got to give it back to them in 3 hours. But now, nobody writes the form. Everything is, you have a handheld device, people do it online. So they don't need my services anymore. They don't need my skills anymore. But then I have my people. What do I do with them? I cannot send them back. So we find ways in which we can stay relevant to customers. So my insurance companies don't give me data entry jobs anymore. But I talk to them and say, hey, I've been with you for like 5-6 years. Can I help you in a premium collection? Can I help you with customer retention? So we try to grow up the value chain. So that's a critical role that we are doing right now. And we are in a crossroad of a phase where a lot of companies have shut down because they've trained over 1,000 and 2,000 people in a particular skill set, and when the skill set become redundant, you don't have anything else to do for the people. So like I said, we work with Google, we do manual curation for analytics firms, we do machine learning support, Google Translate, do you use Google Translate? You must have heard about Translate, right?
Yeah.
So in India, we have Google Translate works in almost about 15 languages. We've done work with Google for about 6-7 of those languages. Social media moderations, we do HR support, we do compliance audit, automation. So while we realize that automation is taking away the jobs, we've also learned that if we can train our people, if we can align ourselves, we can actually still stay relevant to customers. Siri, you use Siri, right? Siri functions in English and a lot of European languages. Now imagine a country like India where you have 22, 25 official languages. And how do you expect Siri to work there? So Siri kind of gets very confused. So we work with Apple to kind of do collecting voice samples to help Siri becoming a better tool back in India. So like Siri, we work with three other agencies that help, that work on voice-based service provision for the rural markets. So DesiCrew, our case study has been featured in a lot of business schools. We conducted a social audit. In fact, we were the first in India to conduct a social audit independently. Our story has been featured in four books. One was launched in New York by Fortune editor. They kind of identified business models that create a dent, and we've been featured in four books. We work with the governments of Tamil Nadu and India in developing the rural BPO policy. And we've been featured in magazines and journals. Interviews have appeared in television. In fact, we just recently appeared at a leading case study TV program in India. So what is the value? So obviously for customers, it's a flexible workforce. There's significant cost advantage. For people, it's gaining qualitative jobs. Now, in the Indian context, if you can go back and see what are the non-agricultural jobs that are there for the rural India, you might not find too many options. For businesses, obviously it's reaching out to newer markets. For community, of course, you have the things that I mentioned. There's lower migration, higher economic value add. In terms of women employees, the benefits are multifold. So these are some of my customers with whom I have worked. Some names I could not use because of an NDA clause. You would see names like Microsoft, you'd see a GSK. I don't know, have you heard about Zomato in London? Anybody heard about Zomato? So Zomato is a leading player in India. So it's again a new age company where we try to see how to address their pain points. Now our engagement with Zomato is not a conventional outsourcing activity. It is just that we met them at I met the founder at one of the forums. Met them, there was something known as the elevator pitch. You must have heard about the elevator pitch, right? I literally had an elevator pitch with him. We were stuck in the same elevator. So he came down from 26th floor to the ground floor, and those 26 floors kind of gave me an entry. We met the team, and we have now a strong engagement working with them. So there are banks, there are leading banks in India, there are NGOs, so a whole bunch of different sectors for whom we do work that is relevant. None of these companies are working with me because I do an impact or social enterprise. They work with us only because they see value of working with the company. So I think the rest of it is just going to be pictures. So this is our center at Kolumangudi. That's a village in south. This lady from the third from the right, your right, that lady is called Kamali. Her name is Kamali. She's 27 years old. Every time we need motivation, we just think about the work that Kamali has done. So 4 years ago, we had like a cyclone that was hitting our center in December. And December is the year-end volume for an insurance company, and the work is critical. So at the time of cyclone, obviously, it was difficult for the employees to even come out of their homes. But this lady was heading the center. We didn't have electricity. We didn't have, let alone internet. So obviously, there was no way of communication. We all were there in Chennai. This lady is in the village. The center is in a village. We didn't even know if work was happening. Nothing was possible. But at 11:30 one night, towards about 27th or 28th of December, she just called from some random number. She said that she found a mobile phone with a charge, and she said that she's actually having a team of 30 people working. We were completely fluxed. We had no idea how she did it. It was still raining, by the way. So she said that she managed to get a cycle and get one of the boys to travel out to the houses and ask the girls to come in when the rain was less. She managed to get a team of 30 people. She managed to get one of the family members to cook for all of them and ensure they all would stay at the office. Now all of that was done on her own. No instructions, nothing came from us. In fact, if no work was done, the client would not have done anything to us, because it is public knowledge that that center was having close to about 200 mm of rain at that time. There was a cyclone hitting. Our internet tower, which is about 40 feet, we were not sure the tower was even standing at that time. And the worst part was, she was calling from a mobile and she said, can we call her back? She said, no, this mobile is going to switch off. I don't have any other forms of communication. So she, all of this we got to know later, but she on her own proactively got the women, got the people to come in. She got, and once with children, she managed to get them also. She managed a shift where somebody would take care of the toddlers. Food was arranged. The genset was not working. Diesel had to be arranged. All of it was done by her. And we only got to know after the client emailed us on the 31st of December, saying that, great job, guys. We're extremely happy. Thank you for putting up. So that was a fantastic way for us to start the new year. And that girl, again, she's again a classic example where her father, again, is a landless farmer, seasonal income earner. She supports her sister's education and a classic motivation for us. And this chap down is an intern from Kenya. So this was taken last week, actually. This was at a wedding ceremony, if you can't make it out. So the boy with the garland is named Shanmugam. Shanmugam joined us in 2009 as a fresher from the local college. He had completed his BCom. He had an opportunity to go to Singapore or Dubai. So in that part of the country, going to Singapore or Dubai would mean that you just gain an illegal entry and then you figure out what you want to do there. So he had that option, but he kind of turned that down, took a job with DesiCrew. He's still with us. He is one of the delivery managers there. And for us, one of our success stories is somebody who started his career with DesiCrew and continues to lead a team and got married. So it's like a whole cycle for us. And he made the mistake of meeting us in Chennai and giving us the invitation when the interns were there. So the intern said that they wanted to attend his wedding. So we landed up there, and as a small ritual, we carried him. That's what we do. So that was about 7-8 years ago. So this is, again, one of our centers. This is a center at a location called E Road. So if you notice, you'll see the security guard and some male species in between. Otherwise, it's mostly the women who, it's a women-dominated setup that we have. So much so that sometimes, when there are like PCs that are delivered by courier, it becomes difficult for the women to handle it. So this center was set up when a customer said that they wanted about 150 people to be set up for a new project. So again, the ladies there, so we have some of our key people who've been with us for about 10 years in this picture. They took the responsibility. They formed this entire team locally. So for us, sitting at Chennai, the high point is that we are able to not just create jobs, but to empower people to become better managers and handle bigger roles in a company. So that's at one of the centers where they conducted a free eye camp for the local villagers. They organized the whole event by themselves. They organized competitions. They invite local leaders to attend visit our center. So one of the problems that we've always had during festival times in India is that people go for long leaves. So we would give them higher incentives. We would tell them, we threaten them with penalties, but none of it would work. So then we said, if it's all about celebration, why don't you just celebrate at the center? So this actually helped. So the harvest festival, the Pongal, the ones on top are the Pongal, the harvest festival. The ones down are Diwali, the festival of lights and crackers. So what we realized is that whatever I may talk about a managerial style or anything that I can say about how a company is to be run, you eventually had to decentralize decision making. And we realized that it is this way that we are able to form leaders. And for us, we've been really fortunate that all the customers who are working with us continue to work with us because of the delivery and the operational excellence that these leaders have shown at the floor level. So in these parts of the country or in the villages, community engagement, right? People coming together to celebrate something doesn't happen frequently. So there are games, the rewards and recognition play a very critical role in these areas. Again, if you see, it's all women dominated. I mean, most of them are. So we also had customers coming and visiting us, so that becomes a very critical part of our business model, where you have the Asia Pacific head who travels from Singapore, traveling about taking a 6-hour journey to visit our center. We have the global head of delivery coming from New York. We kind of compel them to visit our Karnataka Kapu center. I mean, it's a day trip for them. For them to spend a day traveling just to spend about 2 hours at the center is big, but it kind of gives the conviction that the customers are really considering our model. So again, there are some videos that I wanted to play, but I think we'll just take it after our conversation. So they had the UN Day, which was celebrating blue, so they had all turned up in blue. This, they came up in pink, I don't know for what. So again, that's our Karnataka center. So subtle things, right? In this region, you have people from different communities and different religion working in. And there are some communities where the women are not allowed to work at all. So in this picture, there are some people who are like the first timers from their entire community to actually come outside and to engage in a commercial engagement, to engage in work. So now that they have come, they kind of become the trendsetters for the other girls and other younger girls. Because otherwise, parents generally, what they do is they stop education at the age of 17, 18 and just get them married off. But because these girls are earning, because these girls are able to actually send a message that it pays for you to complete your college. It helps when you have a graduation degree. And when you have a job and when you're able to earn, you can be independent. So these are living proof that it helps to continue or allow a girl child to complete education. Now, I'm not too sure if you're able to understand the context or if you're able to connect, but this is a significant shift, or this to us is a huge success for us. So that was at the United Nations, and that's a very poorly taken picture. So again, coming to the point that we are trying to align ourselves to different institutions, not necessarily just customers, but to different institutions that believe in the kind of work that we do and in the mission that we operate on. So in the last 10 years, our employees have always surprised us. We never thought they could do high-end work. We never thought they could do testing. We never thought they could do coding. We never thought they could do certified processes. We never thought they could work on high level of work. It involved, you know, very fine level of decision making. There is a project where our job is to read engineering patents. You know what's a patent, right? So there are patent applications. So it's a 100-page document of mechanical engineering patent. So you have to read those 100 pages and write a 1-page summary. So, and that needs a strong background in mechanical engineering. We never thought that people could do it. They surprised us. You must have heard about MOOCs, massive online open courses, online courses. Yeah. So how many hours of content that CSM have? Any idea? Do you have any content online?
Well,
oh, how many hours? Stanford has close to 7,000 hours.
No.
So we work with the Indian government to provide these MOOCs online. It's available online. Around 15,000 hours of content is available online, engineering lectures, and of which 13,000 hours of engineering lectures transcription is done by our team. So our job is to listen to videos, lectures, and type out everything that the speaker is talking. Everything, verbatim, everything has to be captured in that particular format. To me, that's the most boring job anybody can do. I mean, listening to lecture is one thing, sorry professor, but typing out everything that a professor is saying and doing it day in and day out, I know it could be excruciatingly painful like that, yeah. So we do that job, and we've done over 13,000 hours of such lectures. And this is done by a set of people or a team of people who cannot speak English. They do not have the subject matter knowledge. We just train them in a particular manner that they were able to capture everything that they hear and type it out. They have to recreate diagrams, they have to recreate presentation, they have to recreate formula, and all of this without any domain knowledge. But they've done it. So people continue to surprise us. They always continue to surprise us. So clients have always challenged us. They said, they always say that, can you do this? Can you do that? Obviously, we can't pay you that much. In fact, we're never going to pay you. So they've always challenged us, but we've survived. Media has always loved us. I mean, a lot of stories that have been written about us. We've got some of our biggest customers through media coverage. We've never been a company that was able to afford PR, not that we can even afford it now. A lot of our customers have been acquired through word of mouth advocacies. Again, all thanks to the great work that our employees do. So we've had a competitor who started after us, but who's become much bigger than where we are right now. So he's raised more funds, he's had more people, he's opened more offices, his model was extremely different. And then we also realized that money has always eluded us. I mean, we've received angel investment, we've received two rounds of institutional investment, but as a company, we've never been able to become a unicorn, a startup unicorn. So we've had unicorns come up in like 6 months in India. Somebody starts a company in January and September they're a unicorn. I mean, December they're shut down, that's a different case altogether. But we've never been able to, we've never seen a somebody who can make money. So even now when people talk to us, our management, they say, yes, you guys are really nice, we're happy with you, but I don't think you guys can ever make money in life. I'm like, stop saying that, someday we will. But I've been there for 10 years. My team has been with me for the same amount of period. A lot of our personal journeys, we've been together. All of us started as single. Some got married, some got separated, some were happy after that. But as a team, we've been able to work together. We've been able to evolve this business model. And we continue to stay relevant. There are a lot of companies that have shut shop. There are a lot of companies that could not go beyond the initial first 2 years of investment. But as a company, we are still there. And we're a bunch of dreamers, and I think we will still continue to be relevant. So what's next for us? So we noticed that our skills, our offerings are becoming redundant for customers. So we're trying to shift to customers. We're trying to alter our customer base. People whom we had not been speaking to before. For instance, in 2014, there was a kid who completed his engineering and wanted to work with us, do an internship with us. He did a 2-month internship and left. He got a job at Microsoft Seattle. He turned down the job. He started an image recognition software company in 2015. And in 2016, he raised about $8 million funding. And one of the conditions was that he had to open an office at the Bay Area. So in 2016, he goes there, starts the office, and 2016, he becomes DesiCrew's customer. So he has over 5 million images, and he wants us to do the image annotation, manual tag every image, because he wants to, it's a part of his machine learning process. So we realized that our customers can come from anywhere. It does not necessarily have to be the Citibanks and the Googles of the world. So that's why we are now making ourselves present and visible at different forums. We are talking to the academic institutions, we are talking to startups, we are talking to investors. So we're considering different options where we can stay relevant and somebody would want to work with us. So that way, we're still continuing to dream, we're still talking about our IPO, we're still talking about what would happen when we were to execute a $500 million deal and a whole bunch of things. But one thing that we are more proactively doing is we're reaching out to international markets. So earlier we were very inward looking, we were focusing mostly on the Indian markets. But then we realized that our services are much required and much appreciated in the Western markets, especially in the North American part, in the Western Europe zone, Australia. So as a part of that, we keep traveling, or I keep traveling, and we're trying, a lot of customer acquisition work happens from there. And for us, whatever we are doing right now is basically creating wealth at the bottom of the pyramid. So that's a little bit about how we started as a company and how we are running as a company. I would like to show a few minutes of video if we have the time.
20 years ago, some companies in the US decided to move certain time-consuming processes halfway across the globe to India. Why? Well, mostly to utilize the abundance of talent and to cut costs of manpower, management, real estate, etc. But mainly because it made good business sense. When these ideas were presented, questions were asked. What about infrastructure, security, and management expertise? All of this in the land of snake charmers. Let's forward to present day. Those few jobs have made India arrive on the global stage. They are the backbone of a thriving India, its booming economy, its growing middle class, and its confident youth. Outsourcing is a $180 billion industry, poised to touch $260 billion by 2015. But today, India is facing similar problems which the US had 20 years ago. And those who realize it are taking charge. And once again, rather than moving people to jobs in big cities, they are moving jobs to where the people are. Why? Because it makes good business sense. But the same questions are being asked. What about infrastructure, security, and management expertise? With 60% of the current outsourcing workforce anyways migrating from tier 3 towns and its surroundings, educated talent is in abundance. Add to that, increased public spending on infrastructure. As a result, roads, power, education and internet have reached over 80% of India. DesiCrew, one of the pioneers of this model, has already taken the first few steps and has a 250 plus strong workforce operating in the interiors of Tamil Nadu and Karnataka from 5 centers. The team has taken over all levels of management and function, leaving just around 15 people in the city office. These employees today manage and serve all types of clients like large MNCs, SMEs, NGOs, academic institutions and work across industries like insurance, mobile services, multimedia, internet, digital and many more. DesiCrew's employees now save a lot more. As a result, they are improving the quality of their life, educating their children and bringing prosperity to their hometowns and villages. They are happier working in the village than in big cities and value their jobs more. This motivates them to excel professionally and the newfound confidence rubs onto their daily lives. So, what does this mean for DesiCrew's clients? Well, lower attrition, higher productivity, lower costs, stable workforce, and most of all, it's good business sense. Now imagine how this will benefit not only the business owners, but the entire country. Even if 1% of the estimated $180 billion industry turnover shifts to the rural areas. The answer is clear. DesiCrew. This is BPO 3.0.
For Empowerment Category Awards, so we thought of hiring a professional agency to do it. The quotation he gave kind of made us decide against it. So he gave us a quote of almost about 4 lakh rupees, 400,000 Indian rupees. So we said nothing doing. So we spoke to our people and they said, okay, don't give us money. Give us 2 days leave. We'll do the video. We said, we'll give you money. We can't give you leave. But then we got into an agreement. They didn't take the leave. In their free time, this entire 3-minute video that you're seeing, right from the story, the screenplay, storyboard, dialogue, video camera, editing was all done by our center. So when I said our people don't stop to surprise us, this is one of the initiatives.
Bye. மூத்த பட்டதாரிகள் வேலைவாய்ப்பிற்காக கிராமத்தில் இருந்து நகரத்திற்கு படையெடுத்த காலம் உண்டு. ஆனால் தேசிகுரு வந்ததுக்கு அப்புறம் நீங்க திறமை நிரூபிக்க இது ஒரு சிறந்த இடமா இருக்கு. உங்களாலையும் முடியும்.
After DesiCrew, you know, youngsters like her who are educated don't have to travel to cities. They're able to work from home. So this video was actually shot, the re-recording, everything was done. They just hired a professional camera, but the cameraman was one of our boys who didn't get featured in the video. So this video was completely done by the team. Personally, I wasn't too happy with the output. I don't think it communicated the empowerment story well. I wasn't too sure if it was good enough for a nomination at New York. But just for the effort that the people put in, I kind of sent it. And we didn't put in the subtitles. I didn't know if they could understand. But eventually, we were shortlisted for the finals at the summer at New York this year. So this is the team. That's our center. I hope you had some idea of what the center is. So I was told that a lot of you are working on or ideating on ideas that could solve real-world problems. Because that's one of the phrases that Saloni and myself would always talk about. What are we working towards? We're not earning money for ourselves. We're not building anything for ourselves. We find that we are actually changing the dynamics of the rural culture. We're kind of firefighting with families. We're firefighting with customers. So often we would be asking the question ourselves, is it even worth what we are trying to do? What are we even trying to do in the whole process? But then sometimes we realize the work that we do right now, the benefits may not be known. We may not be even knowing what would be the outcome of the actions that we do. But if we are persistent, if we are honest about our initiative, we realize that the benefits will start to show. So these girls, all of them are employees. The people whom you saw were the real life, were shot at one of the house of our employees. That was her house. That was her father who acted. All of them are excited to be on camera. So for us, it's kind of a testimony that the local community is also understanding the impact that we're doing. We've realized that the government is a bit more sincere in its attempt right now. We are working with the central government, the Delhi government, the Ministry of Information Technology. We work with them on policy formulation. We are working with them on creating rural BPOs across the country. It's a small step, it's taken time, but I think the persistence and the support of the people and our customers and investors who kind of believed in our model kind of helped us to come this far. So it's good to know that you all would be pursuing on creating something in the days to come. So I can't give you any advice, but my request is don't get bogged down by reality. There are some times when you really, really feel like, you know, throwing the whole thing out and just going back and taking the safe route out, which we've kind of felt many a time. But just hold on. So continue with all the pursuits that you would be doing, and I believe that you guys would be creating, you know, things as a part of your course. So it'll be good to hear about what you guys do. I'll probably stay in touch. It'll be good to see you guys progress. And so that's us. And with that, I shall close. I will have your question answered if you want afterwards also. Completing your question, how did we get the infrastructure? So little by little, whatever money we get, once we started getting customers who pay for our services, our investment was mostly on the infrastructure. We did not invest on anything else. We did not work on our salaries. We didn't, we were the senior management people, so we could always fix our salaries, which was way too low in the hierarchy. So we chose to forego our salaries at that point of time. We chose to invest a lot on alternate technologies. We chose to invest on infrastructure. And at one point of time when the investment started coming in, the diversion of the funds was mostly for the infrastructure.